call fundamental skills. The other set of skills is what we call facilitators. And some of it we've talked about. So we've talked about genuineness, we've talked a little bit about empathy, talked a little bit. So confrontation and concreteness. So what do you think, what goes on? What is, let's start with concrete.
There should be accountability, like the learner should be accountable.
You're saying concreteness?
Yeah.
Which one are you?
So I'm talking about concreteness in the sense of that the learner should be accountable, like if assignments are given, he should or she should.
No, but here we are talking about skills.
Sorry, repeat the question. Maybe I didn't articulate it.
So what we are talking about here is the skills to be displayed by the coach. what is the skill of concreteness to be displayed? What is it?
Being very, very specific.
Relevant
to that particular.
So this whole thing we were talking about earlier about using shorter sentences.
Right.
Being very clear, all of that will fall in the concreteness skill. This is not a skill which comes naturally to Indians.
We don't get marks unless we write those four pages.
So yesterday somebody was telling me that they wrote ghazals in a Hindi paper and got maximum marks. No, I'm serious. Somebody told me that he pura lamba likhne ke liye kuch kuch beech mein likha. So anyway, but this, the reason I'm pointing out this skill is that this does not come naturally to us. It's a difficult skill to practice. Concreteness also has an element of that when you are reflecting back to the other person, how accurate are you? So this also has an element of not just precise, being specific, it also has an element of being precise. So let's say whatever you are repeating back to the person, which is one of the skills to understand, then you have to be absolutely accurate that you are not saying anything or doing anything which is outside of that space.
Use of words also will be very useful, no?
So you have to see
a powerful word which use.
What do you mean by powerful words?
This particular word which you use, which use a greater meaning rather than two, three sentences. Or
yes, but greater meaning is a bit dicey. You have to give exactly the same meaning as, this is about precision. If the person is not giving enough meaning, that's how it is. You don't have to add any meaning, that's the point, or subtract anything. Yeah. You must be very concise and concise.
I think also to remain with the concerns and issues, not with the person.
That will go in the irrelevant. In the earlier one we saw this one. So if you are going outside, this is a very specific skill about being very concrete and very, or being very specific and being very accurate in your communication. What about confrontation?
Self-disclosure.
Bringing the right reality in front of you. What is the current situation? Where is he? What is his challenge? And what can be his barriers to help him identify that?
So there are 3-4 dimensions of this. So confrontation is actually not about confronting the person. It is about helping them see the reality, as I think Vikram rightly said. So this could be that they are saying something, so the gap between saying and saying. So last time they told you something, but now they're giving you a useful. It could be between saying and doing. That what is, so they're saying, you know, actually all my subordinates, you know, they really like me and respect me. You see, my attrition is, you know, less than 5%. 360 data is showing that he's a very authoritarian manager and doesn't, you know, listen to them. And they may not be leaving because of many other reasons, for example. So what they're doing and saying could be the other gap. The other is context. That they are not able to see that in this context this is not working, or in this context this is, you know, so like for example, some of the examples we come across very often is that people get to lead, let's say,
metrics teams across countries. So they get promoted into a whatever VP general manager position. They suddenly get to lead a team in a metrics organization, and they struggle. And they are unwilling to realize that there are new set of skills which need to be learned because your people are not sitting next to you anymore. Okay, so the reality is that the context has changed because now you have to lead a team which is, you know, one of the good examples I give always is that Indian managers working in Thailand. How many of you are familiar with the Indian history in Thailand? So there are more Sardar jokes in Thailand about Sardars than there are in India. I'm very serious. There are more Sardar jokes in Thailand than there are in India. Because it is the most hated community. Indians are very highly hated.
In India or Sardars?
Sardars specifically, but it has rubbed off over time on Indians as well. The reason is because many of the jobs, trading jobs, is that all of them were taken away by these people who went in early. And Indians have become all the large trading houses. They've taken away many professions. Also, willy-nilly, we are a reasonably loud set of people. Okay. And Thai culture is very, very soft. Number one, they have a lot more women than men. You know that, right? The gender balance is, I think, almost 60-40 in favor of women. Okay. And they are a very soft, polite culture. And Indians and Sardars in particular are not necessarily. So actually there's a huge cultural clash. So when managers from India go to work in Thailand, and one of my ex-colleagues in Nokia went there, he had a terrible time. And we had to actually look for a coach for him just to help him figure out that the context in which you are operating is, this is the reality. Because in his mind he doesn't see it. He's saying, you know, I've been a manager for 20 years, I've led 5 countries. What's the big deal with Thailand? That's how he sees it. But the big deal with Thailand is that people have a view about Indians. One can argue whether it is the right view or wrong, they are not going there. But that is the reality of the situation. So how do you show... So it's actually, in my mind, it's like a... How do you help the person get a true picture? So you remember we were doing your story, my story, the story. So how do you help the person to move to the story in that story? This is this requires, I think somebody in the morning talked about analytical skills. This does require a certain degree of being reasonably sharp, if I were to. Because otherwise, if you don't catch the nuances, you will not be able to do confrontation. You should be able to catch the nuances because this is a difficult skill to practice. How many of you think you are comfortable with conflict? Let me ask you this.
Will we get questions if we put our hands up?
No, sorry.
Will we get questions if we put our hands up?
Yeah. So,
conflict in general or in a professional workplace or other
organizations?
How many of you are married? Let me ask you this. It's a simpler question. This is a black and white question. Or do you? This is not a gray. This is neither a trick question nor
married
a
or happy.
This you should know, by the way. The answer to this you should know.
Vimal, are you married or happy?
No, I'm asking you a very simple. So, how many of you are married? Just very quickly. I am certainly, but there's quite a lot of you. Right. So then you should know what conflict is. So the reason I'm saying this is this way, and I'm not being frivolous. So the relationship is there, but not everything is, you know, hunky-dory. Personalities are different, ideas are different, things you want to do could be different. They're very different. So conflict by itself need not be bad. And that's why I'm trying to say that this is not a personal or a professional issue. It's that in your mind, do you see conflict as a bad thing or do you see it as a good thing? Okay. So for coaches, this becomes very important that you see conflict as a constructive thing as against a negative thing. Because conflict actually helps you move forward. You know, if you put it in a different way, when you get a perspective which is not your own perspective, do you think you grow? What do you think?
Yes.
That is conflict. What is conflict? Conflict is just not that Shalini has a different perspective or a different point of view to a particular issue than mine. I'm not talking about styles, please don't get me wrong. I'm not talking about the style of fighting or communication, that's not. Right now I'm just talking about conflict, that you don't see the same picture I do. And therefore, I will grow by seeing that different picture. So if somebody can help me see that picture, then chances are that I will grow. So as a coach, you need to be very comfortable that your ability to confront a person and show them that there are other perspectives to this problem. But you should be personally comfortable with it because, okay, let me put it this way. How often do we like it when our wife shows us the mirror or the husband shows us the mirror? That's the journey you have to go through. I'm not looking for an answer, by the way. This one I know the answer, so I'm not asking you for the answer. But that's the journey as a coach you need to go through to feel comfortable that people will have different perspectives. So once you become comfortable yourself, you will also become comfortable at sort of in a way showing the mirror to other people. Okay, so let's do a little bit of practice. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We certainly missed someone.
Susan.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to give you a role play. Okay? Before I give you, have you noted down these skills by the way?
Yeah.
These ones as well?
Yes.
No, you said you're going to give it to us. No, I'll give you certainly, but for the moment, if you can just note down for the purpose of the exercise.
Is there?
If you can pair up, okay, and you will get a role play brief. One is of what is what we are calling the primary character, and one is the secondary character. So please role play.
Yes.
So one is the primary character. One is the secondary character. We want you to have a dialogue. If you can pick any corner of the room. Don't share your character with your partner. The idea is that you have two different characters. Okay. As you go through the dialogue. With your partner, try to see, or at least, you know, even if mentally you can see, which of those skills are in display. So what we would like to see is the examples of display of those particular skills. They could be either in the listening or the pushing, or they could be in some of these other facilitative or fundamental. Just look for, just observe what you are seeing. Okay. As you are dialoguing, look for it in your partner and vice versa, obviously. That which are the skills are you seeing being displayed, and this is also a test in observation. Okay, so the reason why we do this exercise is that we are also looking for you to give us examples of, if you say that okay, this person was being concrete, for example, what did you see which made you feel that this person was being concrete, or what did you experience? Yeah, so this is an exercise in observing some of these skills so that you get a sense of it.
You guys are pair.
Yeah,
you. Okay, so both of you are pair. You and Karma here pair.
No, so you have to partner with someone. So Karma, you have to stay out
because otherwise it will make a even odd
number. Yes. The only thing is, we have one person here who is also not.
No, but that's what I'm saying. As far as if you, there's one person and there's one person, so they can pair up. It has to be an even number.
I thought you said that I have to pair up with
her. You don't have to pair up with her.
My listening skills are not as good as I thought they were.
Okay, so you're pairing up with somebody then? Which one have about, let's say, 10 minutes, okay? So you can pick any corner of the room, start the dialogue, you have the role. You understand the role play, right?
Yeah.
Role play, mein sabse pehle kya karte hai, chalo batao. If you have to play a role, what do you have to do? You've seen the, what, Ranbir Kapoor's and Ranbir Singh's something. You were also Ranbir Kapoor or Ranbir Singh?
Ranbir Singh.
So you
you've seen both the Ranbir. What do you have to do? The first thing you have to play the role, what do you have to do? Let me ask you.
Introduce yourself.
Get into the character.
How do you get into the character? That's an outcome, you're right. But how do you get into the character? What do you have to do to get into somebody else's character? Empathy, okay, let me ask you a simpler question. There was a word called empathy there in the skills. So if I have to be empathetic, what's the definition? Okay, let me reiterate. What's the definition of empathy? Shoes, okay. So what do you have to do if you have to get into somebody else's shoes? What's the first step?
Listen to it.
Come and wear my shoes. What do you have to do? What's the first step to do if you have to wear my shoes?
I have to first take off my shoes.
Yeah, you have to first take off your shoes. That's what you have to do. So when you have to get into your role, the first thing you have to do is to... Abhi samajh mein aaya? Lunch was good. So...
Lights band nahi hue.
Lights abhi karenge, don't worry. Okay, so 10 minutes from now, you go with your partner wherever you can go outside as well as you observe those skills and then come back in 10 minutes. Okay, you can do it inside, outside, wherever. So go out with your partner, start the dialogue and 10 minutes. Okay. Okay, so let's get some specific food. Some of you finished a little bit early. So what happened?
I think in terms of the entire intervention, because I think in your terminology we call it a warrior, you went 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I think both of us were there, possibly because I had encountered this situation in my workplace when I was there. So it became easier for me.
You were the manager and she was the...
Yeah, I was right now I was a secondary character, but there I was obviously the primary character. So I was able to sort of relate to the entire thing very easily, and that made it, you know, sort of fun.
So what did you arrive at if you finished early?
I arrived at that some sort of a solution was sort of a, not really solutions. Eye-opener was in terms of offering a mix of both the things. You know, the idea was to move from one department to another. Okay, because I was sort of saturated in the current role that I was looking. But the problem was there was no opening in that new department. Right? So she said, the primary director said that, you know, okay, we can give you an exposure of maybe spending one day a week or some portion. And also shift you to a new client base. In terms of the existing group, from a set of A clients, you move to B clients. So you got a new sort of a perspective, a new.
Why did she give you that solution?
She said to give you a better role and enrich your role.
I'm asking you a very specific question. Why could you not come up with that solution?
I could have.
But it didn't happen. No?
It didn't happen.
So why did it not happen? Think about it. I'm not looking for an answer. Right?
Okay.
But think about, because is there a way that instead of her coming up with the solution as a manager, you could have come up with the same solution.
Yeah.
Is there a way to do it? Or let me put it this way, in a coaching situation, when will the ownership be more?
When the coaching comes up with
her. I want you to think, so what the question to you in this is that, what happened in the process, in the coaching process or in the dialogue process, because of which she came up with the solution, challenges to give it a thought as to what was happening in the process. Why did it happen? Any other cases like that?
Yes.
Same thing happened.
Same thing.
So, and you guys also finished early, I saw a little bit.
Yeah.
Any other case?
Yeah.
So who was the manager in your case?
I was the manager.
You gave the solution.
Yeah.
No, Vimal, your point here, just to take it further, that why did I not come up with that solution on my own?
No, that's not the question. The question is that in the process, what happened because of which the solution came from the manager. I'm not, so this is not about pointing out rightness, wrongness of the solution, whatever it is. What I'm trying to figure out is that
the process
itself. So what is there happening in the process? Did anybody have a situation where the person themselves came up with 2-3 answers and you arrived at a solution? What is happening? You guys were still there.
Yeah.
What is happening with them? I know you love to talk to each other, but apart from
that, I was so tough with you as a subordinate. Yeah. And we experience silence in between. Yes, to see.
No, but so where were you in the, what stage were you in the when I saw?
So we are almost closing. We are almost in the closer in terms of the conversation.
Yeah, from your perspective.
Yeah, because it was not heading towards a solution. And the message that I was wanting to give it to him is that in terms of saying that the organization values you, unfortunately nothing is available right now. Outside it is available, but if you stay with it, so that's a message. It was not a saying that, and it was just left open there to say that you decide what you want to do. So that's where we were.
Who was the manager for?
I was the manager.
So what happened?
So she started off by saying that I wanted to meet you because you know I've been doing the same role, and I said okay, good to see you, but you know what brings you here. So then I think she came up with a solution right from the beginning for me. And
so I was excited about going into marketing. And
so what was the solution?
She said I want to move into marketing. And
that's a desire. That's not a solution.
I said I want to move into marketing, and then she did mention that there is nothing right now. And then I said okay, I'm okay to take any role within sales also, which is closer to marketing. So that was my thing, that if I don't have something directly,
then you can go.
So can I go? Then she obviously came up with the solution, okay, this is the role that we probably have and it will help.
So I gave her
options,
saying do you want to do key account or institutional, and she said the account would require me to work closely with marketing, so maybe. So I said, do you think that will work? She said, okay, I will look at it.
So let's go back to the earlier and I'll come back to some of the other ones. But so what would you have to do to make sure that the solution is generated by the coachee and not the coach? Because the trick in coaching is exactly this. So in your case, who was the manager?
I was manager.
And who gave the solution? So there are two purposes to this role play. One is for you to understand that there is a deep in our training or education, we are taught to find solutions. So we are always very, and we are good at it by and large, that we will find a solution. But in coaching parlance, that's not the right way to go. So if you have to coach somebody, the more complex the problem, if you want real ownership from the other person, then even though it is the same, it may finally be the same solution, but it has to be generated by the other individual, okay, the coachee in this case. Okay. So how do you then do it is the question. Okay. So there will be cases like this one where the coachee will be immediately saying, this is what I got. But there will also be tougher cases, or there could be cases where the person is just not seeing where to go or what to do.
This one, because it's not a coach and a learner role play, it's more of a manager. And
so in your day-to-day life, aapke paas likha hua aega ki ye problem coach
hai. No, but then as a manager,
even as a manager, when a person comes to you, do you think he or she will say, today I am coming to you as a coach?
No, sir, but I'm saying I would have more cards in my hand.
Sure, it is a role play. So to that extent, yeah, that is there. But I am looking at the behavior.
As a coach, I would be completely, like, I may not know what are the...
So let me reiterate that. Right now we are, at this point of time, because we are doing a role play, we are focused on the skills. So right now the focus is only on the skills. So what I am trying to figure out with you in a way collectively is that, is there a propensity to
give solutions,
Because see, all of these skills should finally add up to what? They should add up to your becoming a skilled coach. Now, whether you finally do executive coaching or you do coaching in your workplace is a separate choice you will all make, right? Or maybe do multiple things, yeah.
It's again the way that you said, I'm sorry, I don't know your name. Simone. The way you said that in that scenario, I will have 4-5 cards in my hand. The idea is not to have any card in your hand. The idea is for you to make him choose the card from the pack.
But what I'm saying is, I would have the knowledge and I would have
them. You have a better background. Which I agree. Yeah, yeah.
Which is
fair.
Which is fair.
That's a fair point. You will have a lot more
which
background.
Which is why I could offer him things from that perspective.
Or not off. Actually,
or not
off. No. Actually, what you're saying is exactly contradictory to
good.
No, no, no. That's not what I'm saying. So, what will happen if you have more information to tell you?
It's
people.
I would be able to tell him, you can do this in my
what's
no
your
choices.
Life? Sorry, I'm doing this to Simone because I'm from Goa. Okay. Right? What did she say just now? I will tell him what to do. See, the problem...
But then the options are there.
But why will you tell him? That's the point I'm raising.
Because I want to retain him. He's a value.
I agree.
I want him.
So your intention of the outcome, I'm not disagreeing at all. Right now, I'm just talking about that in a coaching process. Can you still get to the same end which you are trying to do to retain him and all of that? But do you have the patience to go through the process? I'm using the word patience very deliberately. To actually go through a dialoguing process where that person travels his journey and not your journey. See, this is the difference. In mentoring, the person would travel your journey. In coaching, the person has to travel their journey, which may or may not be your journey. That's the problem. Do you get the sense of what I'm trying to say? So, your intention is absolutely fine, okay? So, no debate with the outcome I'm looking for, because in a managerial role, I want to retain the person, the valuable person, all of that. But is there a way of practicing the skills where you can help the person to carry on their journey? That's the point. And how would you do it is the question. So, if I were to ask you, some of you, let's get some observations around what I asked in the beginning. So, how many of you felt that your partner was using, or let's get some examples of some of the skills you may have used. Yeah.
So
you were the manager or the co-
I was the employee.
You were the employee.
So we were very much at the early stage of the conversation. We didn't even get to that. But in during that piece, I think two things that I saw were acknowledging and probing. And the acknowledging was, you know, when I said that, you know, I've performed well over the last year, da, 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 and she kind of played that back, and I think that may also be a
what
bit
do you
of
mean
reflect.
That? What did she do? She
played.
See, this is what you're going to watch for. When you say played that back, that was the impression on you. What
right.
was? What did she actually
specifically,
do?
Oh, yeah. So she said, when she responded to me, she said that she had also seen that the performance had been good, that I'm a member of the high potential program. So she added to what I said as well, acknowledging kind of my contribution as somebody who had exceeded expectations. And then I raised my interest in kind of moving to a new
role. So if you look at your sheets and look at those five, and you know, just notice to what she's saying, those five facilitative skills,
mm-hmm.
which of those skills is actually coming across? Actually, more than one word.
So I think.
So acknowledging and probing, you certainly said, which was the previous stage.
Right, the fundamental.
But now, this five, which are the ones which are coming across?
Empathy, warmth. I think in my interaction with her, I felt genuineness and concreteness in terms
but
of.
The way you explained it. I'm saying that in addition to that,
yeah.
I felt that you found the conversation very warm.
Yes. Yes.
Genuine and warm.
Correct.
Concreteness, I don't know, because the words you used were, she added a few things to what I said.
Correct.
To me, that is not concreteness.
Understood.
As soon as she adds concreteness, it's gone. Warmth and genuineness is fine. Concreteness is about being
precision,
right? So the way you explained it right now,
right,
what came across to me was that she was, apart from the probing and acknowledging, she was certainly coming across as being very genuine and warm.
Yes.
Concreteness, because you said that she
sure,
added a
sure.
few things. See, as soon as you add, concreteness goes away, because concreteness is about being specific. You neither subtract nor add. What
understood.
Is there. Simple. Period.
Understood.
Okay? But do you see, because even in the way she explained right now, you will be able to sense the
skills which she has experienced. Do you see that? Because see, a lot of this thing is very, how do I put it?
Intangible.
Nebulous, intangible, gray. So you should be able to, you know, experience it yourself. Yeah. Okay.
Sir, one is a skill, another is a data. For example, in her group, she was talking about key account manager, all those options. But in our group, it's, I felt it that there's a clear mandate.
How did you hear what she was talking
about? She shared, You shared that you have given her option of, as a communication. So here I felt it, the general manager has been told there is no vacancy and it has to be 2 years time, whatever. So it is totally on the data or the fact also, how you share those things, you know, because grounds are different. So even though he wants to use that skill, then there's a fear also, again I'm committing something.
No, fair enough. I think that's a fair point that, you know, data will help in some ways. But I'm also saying that data will also impede in some ways. Because the role play given to her and to him was the same.
Same, that's all. But he don't have that option. And she has no option. I'm just referring here and now. So what happens sometime in that situation, she may commit saying that through this role you come or that role you come. But then in real life you don't have.
In real life, here's what happens. How many Devdas movies have been made?
Too many.
Three.
That is a judgment. I'm asking you for data.
Three, four.
Dilip Kumar played one, I know.
KL Sehgal.
And
Abhay Deol.
Okay, take it, fair enough. So, do you think, given, see, because the character is supposedly the same, okay, the script is more, at least Devdi was a little bit differently made, but let's take the other three. But each character plays the same role in a very different way. They will always bring their own framework, mental model, all of that to it, right? So the same, see, the question you need to answer is that even in organizations, the same manager role, Simone may do in a completely different way than Kishore or, you know, somebody else, because in their mind they see it in a particular, you know, that pyramid thing which Vikram nicely explained to us. You need to understand that we have our own biases, we have our own ways of looking at things. Even in a script like this, some people will be a lot more imaginative.
Right.
Some people will frame in their own mind, okay, this is what an organization can look like, so I can give all these options. Or I can draw out these options, whichever way. Somebody may say, no, but I have to strict exactly to what is written. That's a view of how you take your own view to the same role. See, even in organizations, it is the same situation. That somebody tells you are a product manager, or you are a whatever, sales manager, or you are HR manager, or whatever. What you make of it is completely dependent on you.
So I see there is a consistency in using empathy, warmth, humaneness, but wherever there is a correctness and confrontation comes,
concreteness
and this, there where I think those skills, no, those ideas, is really, taking you this side or that side?
Which side?
I'm saying, if you have those options, then you feel okay in a concrete way she has given those options of.
No, but concreteness is not only totally about the option. Concreteness is also about whatever the other person is saying, are you able to reflect back exactly the same?
And in this,
are you able to?
In two situations, I can say there is a rope of hope, you know. He's saying that I can still go to marketing through account, key account manager role and all. Here it is 2 years and you won't be able to do so. It's such area, then you say, oh, is he hinting me to go out of the organization? You have choice. I'm just saying.
I agree with you.
What has happened is here and now, but I'm just saying how particular situation also as a coach, we look at it, the skill, then you can use it, that five.
Sure.
Versus sometimes you get stuck in three only. And other two you struggle.
No, but you know, you don't use the skills independent of each other. What you need to understand is that they all go together. So all of the skills we've talked about, questioning, listening, all of
that was very nice in our group also.
In
very
this
nice
case, let me go back for a minute. So in Simone's case, when she was giving solutions, which of the five was actually very high? Or actually two of them. Concreteness would likely be, I have not listened to the supposition.
Concreteness.
But possibly because she was very clear that these are the 3, 4, 5.
And genuineness also.
Genuineness. Because there was a
keen desire
that I want to actually help this person.
Yeah.
Okay. So to your point and to the earlier discussion, I just want to make sure that by using one particular skill will not make you a good or a bad coach. Because in this case, the outcome was not, perhaps in the short term, the outcome is good. But what has she done? Sorry, Simon. What do you think, or the other group where you gave the answer, what is the longer term outcome of that? What do you think is the longer term outcome? When I give a solution to my employee, what do you think is the longer term outcome?
I didn't get
your
question.
No, so
it's when it does not, when the result,
okay, let me rephrase that question. What does it do to the person's own abilities? What are you doing to that person?
Discount him. You're not helping him decide.
You're
challenging them.
So some coaching language mein aa gaya yaar, main bada practical sawal. You're not challenging. What you are doing is you are making them dependent on you.
Yeah.
You are taking away their solution creating ability. You are almost telling them, you are a joker, you can't find your own solutions. I am being crude right now to prove a point. What you are doing is that you are making them dependent on you as a manager. So every time they have a problem, they will come to you. This is what, so organizationally it is actually a very bad thing you are doing. You are not helping, see, you are thinking you are helping the organization. Actually you are not. You are being very genuine, you are being caring, all of that. But from a coaching perspective, you are not being particularly smart. Please understand this. What you are doing is you are making that person dependent on you, which is not a very helpful situation in the long run. In the short, and by the way, again, please understand, we talked about this earlier. There will be times when as a manager you don't have the time, it's a crisis situation, you have to do this. But that is not coaching. That's all I'm saying. That is problem solving as a manager, which is fine. It has its place and time. But then you should club it with coaching. In coaching, you will have to make sure that the person comes up with alternatives, with the solutions, and you are also helping the person think in a different way. That's how they will, next time the person will figure out their own way before they come to you with a dialogue. You know, you've seen managers, you know, sometimes some managers, when you go to them with a problem, they will give you the answer immediately. With some managers, they will tell you, "Acha, tumne kya options socha hai? Have you worked through these options? So what is your recommendation?" That is in a way a coaching style. Okay, where the manager is not telling you, he may have an answer. He may, finally you may arrive at the same answer. But he will ask you those questions. Saying, "Acha, so which are the 3-4 options you looked at? What's the benefit of this one? Did you do a cost benefit analysis? Did you look at advantage this one?" You felt, I'm sure you all experienced managers like that, right?
Yeah.
And there'll be some managers you go in and they will immediately tell you, "This is the answer, go do it." So that's the difference between a coaching style and a non-coaching style. Okay, on the skills, other observations I'm looking for, particular skills. With your partners, what did you observe, not observe?
Listening.
What?
So she was listening to me, she was letting me complete my sentence,
okay,
and then was coming up with the solution, the answer.
In fact, in our role play, I forgot the whole coach concept. Honestly,
you brought yourself to the table. So that's what
I honestly forgot that manager, so I should be playing the coach. I forgot that aspect. And in fact, she and I was just trying to figure out what's this role play going to look like. And before I could make some sense out of it, she put me under stress as to, "So what option do you have?" Okay, what option? Okay, I gave her one option. She didn't like it. And I said, "Okay, am I supposed to come up with another option?" So I came up with another option. Finally, she agreed with me. I said, "Okay, I think
I'm ready."
So, I mean, actually, I'm sorry. I just forgot this concept. I should have brought in the coach bit in the manager. I think if I did the role play again, it would be something different.
No, that's okay. See, by the way, please don't, you know, you are what you are, firstly. I think you accept that, you know, all of us do this from time to time, you know. So while I'm talking about it, a couple of examples, but this is not to be taken only for the purpose of learning in this group, okay? So we all do it from time to time when we are shortage of time, when we are, you know, we tend to go back to our natural behavior because that's the way we have been brought up.
Right, and if I had to relate to the natural aspect of it, since I'm a person who likes to help people out and give solution, give comfort, I thought this is what I am supposed to do, which is why I came up with the one solution.
And that's the point we were discussing earlier in the morning, that, you know, because you like to help people,
yeah,
it may be good that you become a counselor or a whatever, which is fine, which has its own place. See, please understand, none of these helping relationships are bad by themselves.
Mm-hmm.
They are all good because they are helping people in a constructive way, okay? But don't do coaching, don't do counseling under the garb of coaching, but don't do problem solving under the guise of coaching. That's all I'm saying.
Okay.
So by itself, none of it is good or bad. Good.
Manager actually had a good confrontation style as well, apart from the other mix, which was good. So in terms of, she very specifically asked me, okay, how many years of sales experience do you have? And I said, it's 5 years, so I mean 5 to 10 years. So like, do you think you have already saturated thing because you want to shift to marketing? So that was one. The second was, when I, she asked me this, saying that how many years of your career do you have further ahead of you? So I kept on saying that, I did not answer it, but I said, I want to grow fast. I don't want to become a business head at the age of 50. She said, you've not answered my question. You know? So it was very good because she made me actually say, okay, if I am looking at it, I'm looking at the next 10 years or 20 years. So she did very well. So that was very good.
I'm sure it must have happened to her in her career. Do you agree with that? I'm not.
No, but I think I'm fortunate to have had a couple of very good coaches.
See,
the scenario was
this
not.
This is the other thing, you know, and the reason I'm bringing this up is that if you do this to people in a proper way, it actually grows.
Yeah.
Because she has an experience, she's able to then help you. And then you have that experience. And see, one of the things we like about coaching, personally, I'm really passionate about this because it's like an organism. You know, you do it to 10 people, 10 people do it to another 10, and you know, it sort of is a. It's a very funny thing. So when you know, somebody was mentioning in the morning, when you talk about building a coaching culture, it is not about some great big plan. Pick the right few guys, do it, and it will sort of then, you know, expand. Because you've got an experience of a couple of good coaches, then you know what do they do, and therefore you can then, you know, sort of do it. Okay. So we covered Wilfred. Okay. So what about, did you see any areas of the negative behaviors that you notice, discounting, or I know we don't like to talk about negative behaviors, but I still want to bring it up if at all you noticed,
yeah.
Discounting or judging.
Little bit. To the fact where I'm unhappy and said very clearly that, you know, I'm disappointed. Yeah, but you have been a good performer with us. Okay, and again I'm saying I'm disappointed. See, so it's something that you've always been doing as a good performer. I said, oh, yeah, that's past. As a person, I will think that, you know, that's history.
My current problem is this.
Current problem is, I'm not getting what I'm looking at. Heart sales is over. Yes, sales is something which I've done. I've, you know, achieved that. I'm excited to do something more. So what in that you want to do more? Have you have a plan for that?
So what did you feel like, Vikram? Let me ask you this. So when this was happening,
this is not listening to me.
Actually, that's what happens. You know, we... And in all, see, she may have been saying that
with
all
her.
No, but it's good because I think these are examples and this stays within the room, by the way. Okay.
Yeah.
So the idea is to learn, so it's okay. So, see, this is what happens because you have your own picture. You think you are. Why were you doing this? Let me ask you.
Because
honestly
speaking, I'm not a very good listener.
No, but whatever. But what was your motivation when you were telling him you are a good performer or whatever? Why were you doing it?
Because I wanted him to listen to my solution, whatever I have come prepared with. You know, so I wanted to tell him, this is what you're good at.
And
this
what?
Is what I think you should be doing. And, you know, this is what will help not only you, but also the organization.
So that's the next step.
Yeah.
But when you did this, saying that you are a good performer or you perform well or whatever, what do you think that statement itself will achieve? Why would it help you move to the next step?
Probably he will...
intention is still positive. That's what I'm saying. So
even
she will be doing it because of
what
good intentions.
Even if I take it mutually, and I'm not being Vikram, but being whatever, Pranay, I know that that's not my problem right now. I know what you're telling me. I know your intentions, but God damn it, give me the position. That's what I'm here to have a discussion on. I'm not here to have a discussion on how much you like me.
So the concept we talk about, just to build on that, is this whole issue. So, you know, the solution thing which we talked about in two or three cases is about my story, your story. If your story is very strong in your head, you are likely to be a very solution kind of a person. And so you need to realize that you have to start from his or her story and go to the story. That's one step. We already talked about that.
The other is what we call intent versus impact.
You have heard this, no? I judge others by their behavior, but I judge myself by my intentions. You heard this? So I judge others by their behavior, but I judge myself by my intentions. And one of the issues we like to talk about from a skills point of view is that does the coach actually realize in a way or understand what is the impact they are having on the other person as against what they intend to communicate. So I may intend to, I'll give you a very simple example, okay. So I had a, and this is an interesting case, so one of my, early years, so I'm talking about sort of 15 years back. So I had a young, lady working for me. She had just passed out of one of the, premier institutes, came to work for me about a year into the job. And her marriage got fixed and she got, married. She was one of the most hardworking people I have met in my life. Okay, come in, I used to come in at 8 in the office, time being 9. She would be there before me, she would be leaving normally after I would leave and all of that stuff. Okay. Now, when she got married, I would, and in all of my genuine this thing, interest ki yaar, matlab nahi shaadi hui hai kind of thing. So at 5:30, I would pick up my tea normally and I would ask her, kya hua aaj ghar nahi ja rahe? So I did this a few times over a month or something, and then one day she came to me and she said, Bimal, I want to talk to you. Why do you keep telling me this, that why am I not well? I said, what happened? Yeah, you were newly married, I thought, you go and spend some time at home, you're living with your in-laws, But the impact on her was that I was already discounting her as a high performer. She said that you don't think of me as a high performer anymore. You are already assuming that because I am married, I will spend less number of hours and I will not work as hard. See, look at the implication. Because in her mind, she's seeing the behavior as completely different. In my mind, I am seeing the behavior as completely different. In my mind, I was seeing it being caring and, really giving space to all of that stuff, right? In her mind, she's thinking of it very differently. And it's a great lesson for me personally that, not to, because I have an impression of what I should be doing because, so for me, that's the behavior I associate with being caring. But that's not the behavior the other person is. They are evaluating it through a very different lens. So in coaching, you have to realize that you have to work with the other person's lenses and frameworks and how they are seeing the impact as against the intention you may have.
So I think this is one aspect that I felt came out over here, and again going back to psychology, that's like my reference point. Yeah, most of the time all of us actually come with our own intent, and sometimes we don't have the option to just sit and explore what this person wants or even give what this person wants, right? There are constraints. What helps there is to avoid such a frustration happening is just acknowledging what the other person says. Sometimes people understand that, you can't help me, you can't provide a solution, but if you acknowledge, yes, it's understandable that you're feeling disappointed in your place, so would I, or it's absolutely justified for you to feel disappointed or sad, upset, I get it, you'll be angry. Even if you don't actually get it, right? Because, you expect a high performer to also be highly engaged. The fact that you acknowledge how that person is feeling automatically diffuses that situation, that, that person starts to feel, oh, she's listening and she's on my side, right? Because that kind of helps diffuse any conflict, because I wasn't already coming that they don't care enough about me or there's a wall between us. When you acknowledge that, thing goes away. Then it becomes easier to tell them, I have a solution. That's one
thing. But do you not raise expectations by doing that?
You're acknowledging the feeling, but you're not giving a solution. So it's okay for the person to be angry. It's completely understandable. What to do now about it is still up for this thing, up for discussion, right? What you've done here is you've diffused the person's frustration with the system, with the person, with everything. That they're not even listening to me, so forget solution. I'm not even happy enough with this conversation to start with. But the moment you say, okay, Karu, you know what? You're right. It's okay if you're angry. Like, I completely understand where you're coming from. then I know, okay, even if nothing comes out of this, I have a friend in you and I can trust you to at least listen. So, you know, there you're diffusing my frustration a little bit and you're collapsing a wall that I already built between me and you because I'm frustrated that nobody even listens.
In that case, in addition to those probing and file, listening type is also matter. So fully listening, feeling everything,
absolutely.
I can give that kind of comfort to him versus selective or auto my own answers and try to put that. Maybe okay, some.
Let's make this a little more complex. Okay.
Yeah.
So two things, I think, in addition to whatever we've talked about in skills. So in communication, and some of you may be very familiar with this. So in communication, they say that about 55% of the communication happens by body language.
Mm.
Okay.
Yes.
I think about 37%, I think they say, is by tone of voice.
38%.
And only the remaining is by?
7%
is by the actual words. Now, all of our training and education is to focus on this. Okay. We very rarely focus. So in coaching, one of the things we have to learn, if you want to become a coach or even evaluate coaches or whatever is, to look at what is it that, how are you coming across to the other person? Because the impact is not so much with the words as with the share of voice and, with the tone of voice and with the
body language
and how you come across. And both positive and negative, you know, depending on. So next role play when we do, you need to keep all of the things. So okay, so let's just quickly recap. What are the things you have to keep in mind when you do the next role play?
You don't have your solution. The coaching comes
the
conversation.
Then
I never forget it by that.
Try to help the other person come to
the solution.
Okay. Again, go back to the morning. What did we say? First thing we started with?
Help the healthy.
Correct.
Simple. It's not complex. Okay. What is? Practical tips, the skills, of course, the
listening,
questioning, the facilitative skills, the other skills. What else? What are the 3 or 4 tests you can check for?
How does the conversation end?
Not necessarily.
Share of voice.
Share of voice was one we spoke about. What else?
My story. Yeah.
My story.
These
what
stories.
Is? Which is partly the solution thing actually. What else? What are the other key tests you will check?
Intent and impact.
Not carrying
the monkey on your back. What else? One or 2-3 other simple things. We've spoken about a few things. So communication is another one. So start looking at, you know, if you're aware of your own body language, tone of voice. Some of it we can't change, but you can. What else?
Listening,
questioning, wo to hai. I think the other thing is, the other thing is to be aware of our own biases. How do biases show up, by the way? In a dialogue or in a conversation, how do biases show up?
Maybe by expression.
Okay, what else?
By discounting.
So those 3 negative skills, you're right. So the 3 negative skills, where you are being judgmental,
discounting,
that is how your biases are more likely to show up. But they also show up in the kind of words you choose.
Yeah.
In the kind of, you know, language you use or the sentence formation or your body language behavior, all of that, your biases will show. See, even a bias like what Charlie was saying, I don't remember the exact word you used, but basically you are saying that, you know, as a person I'm very anxious to give solutions. I mean, anxious is my word, not yours. That's why I'm trying to remember what you said.
Yeah.
But the way you came across that time was that, you know, there's almost a great desire here, solution help to karna hi hai is bande ko kind of thing. You know, all not in those are my words, as I said. But that is a very strong bias. We are not, so by the way, here when we are talking about biases, we are not talking about a good bias or a bad bias. why do you think we are not talking about a good bias or a bad bias? Just to understand.
Because to the person, it's a bias.
It's the intent and impact issue. Because in your mind, a good bias is a good intention. But how it comes across to the other can be something completely.
You know, you can share few things on reflection, because on probing, acknowledging, we have those
subordinates,
horizontal, all those things. But in reflection, anything other than we say paraphrase or something, because that's one area which I think can make us approach a little deeper. And
so maybe a couple of quick tips on reflection. So one is, you know, obviously the listening part has to be
very, very
easy. You can't reflect if the mirror is bad, so to say. So your ability to listen has to be, you know, very, very good. Okay. So you have to. But on a practical side, let's say there are two or three things which I do, I can share with you. For example, if I have a coaching meeting at 9 o'clock, I try to get in half an hour earlier to whichever the location is. And generally, I'll order a green tea or a black coffee or whatever. Just sit down peacefully and try to clear the clutter from my mind. Because, you know, listening is the issue also of how much clutter is there in your mind. And in today's day and age, you know, you get hundreds of messages, all kinds of WhatsApp, whatever else it is. So your mind is often very cluttered. So how do you, so you must have a mechanism of cleaning your mind a little bit, okay, just as a tip. So what I do is I switch off my phone, I put it in the bag. This is half an hour before the conversation, not at the time. And just sit down and have a cup of coffee or tea or whatever it is. No. And I also typically choose places which don't distract you. So even if so, you know, sometimes with senior people, you are in a restaurant or something, or a coffee shop early in the morning somewhere. Typically, I choose a place which is right at the corner, quiet, no distractions, you know, no noise of cutlery and, you know, all of that stuff. So these are some very basic tips which will help you become a little bit centered. But on a more broader basis, if you have to become a coach, I think, or you have to look at reflection as a natural practice. You know, there are some very basic things around meditation and yoga, and you know, all of you have to practice some of those over a period of time in your own way. You know, whichever. Some people, like I know one of my very good friends who's a coach in Australia now. He does this, the Osho, whatever they call it. I don't know. You know, that dance meditation types. I don't. There's a name for it. I'm forgetting now. So he does that kind of meditation. But the idea is that can you clear and settle your mind? I think that is the basic thing. So people use different techniques, but the idea is that is your mind settled and not going, you know, all over the place. I think that's the basic thing you have to learn. And unfortunately, we, you know, in today's day and age, it's a very difficult one to achieve. So it is a tough one.
Basically, you need concentration, you are trying to say. So you are focused, you are centered, you are 100% there, kind of a thing.
Yes, that's part of what I'm saying. But what I'm also saying is that when a person is talking to you, focus is one part, but is your mind empty of other thoughts? So focus is one aspect of it, but is it an empty vessel or is it already full and therefore you can't pour anything else into it?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's do the next role play, because I think doing is always a more useful one. Let's keep the same pairs. But change the rules.
I just want to know that you are good. Do you have any plans?
No, maybe this then will be too close.
Take it further height. Yeah. Do you have any thoughts?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you want to do good work. You think anything is coming in this? You feel
I'm learning new things in my field of work. Somewhere down the line, I also want to be known as an expert like you are today in this field.
So what is your understanding when you're saying I'm an expert? What is your picture about me? You see which is making me expert and which you would like to be? I'm happy to.
You just have to answer. Everybody looks upon it. Anything in this field.